When Tom Kettle dies in September 1916, one of his great friends, who's Oliver St John Gogarty, says there were many eyes wet with tears in Dublin when they heard of Tom's death, and not only women's. And I think that kind of summarises the way that he was loved, really, in Dublin. And he's an interesting character, Tom Kettle. He has been a nationalist MP, obviously. He's been a professor of economics in UCD. He is in some ways enemy number one for a lot of advanced nationalists as the years go by into the 20th century, because he is universally seen as very, very intelligent and very modern and progressive. And while many of his friends in UCD are kind of slowly making their way over to Sinn Féin from the Irish Party and so on, he's one of the few who stays firm. At the same time, you don't find much criticism of him in the advanced press. I mean, there is criticism, obviously, but he's treated with a kind of respect that is unusual in advanced political circles, where they're not shy about having some pretty firm things to say about Redmond and Dillon and various others. Tom Kettle is usually pretty much left alone, partly because his personal history was difficult, and it's pretty clear that most of nationalist Dublin anyway knew that he was an alcoholic. And was frequently in recovery during these years, in the years after about 1912. Going to war is the last big decision he makes, and his reasons for going to war are in some ways very similar to the reasons that John Redmond gave about Belgium and that sort of thing. And he also did seem to genuinely think that the war might bring unionists and nationalists together. But he's also much more critical of the war than I think people have allowed. He wrote his last letters home, talk about the futility of war. He's horrified by what he sees in the trenches. He's probably quite ill at that point as well, but insists on going. He's tried to go several times. He's tried to be sent to the front several times, but has been refused before he's finally allowed, mainly again because of his alcoholism. When he does go, he is by all accounts very well liked. Very well loved by his men, insists on going out with them. I think one of the most intriguing things about him is just when he dies, because it's obviously after the Easter Rising, of which he doesn't approve. It is at a time when nobody quite knows in Ireland quite what's going to happen. And he is thinking about what might happen in his last letters, and he's talking about which of his essays he wants published and who he wants to publish them and what sort of message he wants to leave behind. He is a real casualty of this period and of the historiography as well, I think, because he has been kind of left out more than he should be as someone who was hugely important in his own way, but more importantly was seen to be someone who would shape the new Ireland in very profound ways.